Today's story happened about 300 years ago, when North America was known as the colonies, the English colonies. People lived along the East Coast in colonies using names for kings and queens such as Georgia, Carolina, Virginia, or names borrowed from the Indians such as Connecticut, Massachusetts. Life in the colonies was difficult, often very, very hard, especially in winter, and especially for a newcomer. And that's what the story is about. The Witch of Blackbird Pond, and the newcomer, Kit Tyler. Now, Kit Tyler was born down here in the Caribbean, on an island known as Barbados. Now, these people in this region had no concept of the harshness of life of these people in this region, and vice versa. They had no idea of the long winter nights here, things such as snow and ice. And these people had no idea of the endless paradise of the Caribbean, of year-round summer, of tropical fruits such as coconuts and bananas. Well, this was the life Kit Tyler was born to. For 16 years, she lived a very happy life until she lost her parents and finally her grandfather. There was no one for her to live with in Barbados. Her only relative was an aunt she had never met, an aunt who lived in Connecticut. So Kit had to go to Connecticut. As she came to the shoreline here in a little town named Saybrook, she suddenly realized what a different world her aunt lived in. It was still winter there. The sky was gray, the trees were bare, the banks of the river, the Connecticut River, were just mud. She wondered how anybody could live in such drab surroundings.
She turned to watch the sailors stowing provisions into the longboat. She already regretted this impulsive trip ashore. There was no welcome for her at this chill Saybrook landing. She was grateful when at last the captain assembled the return group and she could climb back into the longboat. Four new passengers were embarking for the trip up the river, a shabby, dour-looking man and his wife, and their scrawny little girl clutching a wooden toy, and a tall, angular young man with a pale, narrow face and shoulder-length fair hair under a wide-brimmed hat. Captain Eaton took his place aft without attempting any introduction. The men readied their oars. Then Nathaniel, coming back down the road on a run, slipped the rope from the mooring, and as they pulled away from the wharf, leaped nimbly to his place with the crew. They were halfway across the harbor when a wail of anguish broke from the child. Before anyone could stop her, the little girl had flung herself to her knees and teetered dangerously over the edge of the boat. Her mother leaned forward, grasped the woolen jumper, and jerked her back, knocking her down with a sharp cuff.
"Ma! The dolly's gone!" the child wailed. "The dolly Grandpa made for me!"
Kit could see the little wooden doll, its arms sticking stiffly into the air, bobbing helplessly in the water a few feet away. "Shame on you," the woman scolded. "After all the work he went to, all that fuss for a toy, and then the minute you get one, you throw it away."
"I was holding her up to see the ship. Please get her back, Ma, please. I'll never drop it again."
The toy was drifting farther and farther from the boat, like a useless twig in the current. No one in the boat made a move or paid the slightest attention. Kit could not keep silent. "Turn back, Captain," she ordered impulsively. "'Twill be an easy thing to catch." The captain did not even glance in her direction. Kit was not used to being ignored, and her temper flared. When a thin whimper from the child was silenced by a vicious cuff, her anger boiled over. Without a second's deliberation, she acted. Kicking off her buckled shoes and dropping the woolen cloak, she plunged headlong over the side of the boat. The shock of cold, totally unexpected, almost knocked her senseless. As her head came to the surface, she could not catch her breath at all. But after a dazed second, she sighted the bobbing piece of wood and instinctively struck out after it in vigorous strokes that set her blood moving again. She had the doll in her hands before her numbed mind realized that there had been a second splash, and as she turned back, she saw that Nathaniel was in the water beside her, thrashing with a clumsy paddling motion. She could not help laughing as she passed him, and with a feeling of triumph, she beat him to the boat. The captain leaned to drag her back over the side, and Nathaniel scrambled in behind her without any assistance.
Such water, she gasped. I never dreamed water could be so cold.
She shook back her wet hair, her cheeks glowing, but her laughter died away at sight of all of their faces. Shock and horror and unmistakable anger stared back at her. Even Nathaniel's young face was dark with rage.
On that day, Kit made an undying enemy, good wife Cruff, the mother of the little girl. It seems that at the same time going on in New England, there were witch hunts and witch trials. And one way of deciding whether a woman was a witch was to throw her in the water. If she floated, she was a witch. If she sank, she wasn't. So any poor woman being subjected to the trial by water lost either way. Well, Captain Eaton tried to explain to Goodwife Cruff that where Kit was born and where she grew up, girls were expected to swim. But somehow that didn't convince the old woman. Well, when she got to Weathersfield, Kit had another disappointment. Her uncle Matthew Wood. She liked her Aunt Rachel right away and her two cousins, Judith and Mercy. They were quiet girls, but good-natured. But Uncle Matthew was stern and strict. He didn't like the way Kit was dressed. He ordered all of her pretty dresses locked away and put away. She had to dress like Judith and Mercy, in gray and brown and black. She also had to work. She wouldn't be called Kit anymore, but Catherine. She finally got used to the chores and going to church and sitting in long meetings. It was at one of those meetings that Kit saw Goodwife Cruff again. She was no friendlier than she had been at first. She made Kit nervous. After a while, there came a rare occasion that Kit could relax. Judith took her to a beautiful meadow. Spring was in the air now, and that was the one place that could compare with the beauty of Barbados. Kit noticed that beyond the meadow, there was a marsh and a river, and there was one single hut standing in the marsh. Judith told her that that was where Hannah Tupper lived. Widow Tupper was believed to be a witch by everyone in Connecticut. Kit couldn't understand how people could believe in witches, but she'd seen so many things and heard so many things in Connecticut that she wasn't surprised. Finally, summer rolled around, and Mercy began teaching the little children at home. She'd been approved by the schoolmaster, and she had 11 little children who came there for instruction. Kit helped her. Kit would read the children stories from the Bible. Then one day, she got the bright idea of letting the little children act out the story. This time, it was the story of the Good Samaritan. Unfortunately, the kids got out of control, and a fight broke out. Just at that moment, the preacher and the schoolmaster happened to be coming by. They were shocked. They chastised Mercy and Kit. And even though Kit pleaded with them to blame her and not Mercy because it was her idea, that didn't change matters. She was so angry and upset that she ran from the house and ran down to the meadow. It seemed that everything she said and did was wrong in this strange place. And right now, she just wanted to be alone.
She scarcely knew where her feet were taking her, but something deep within her had chosen a destination. She did not stop until she reached a great meadow. There, and without thinking, she left the pathway, plunged into a field, and fell face down in the grass, her whole body wrenched with sobs. The tall grass rustled over her head and hid her from sight, and the meadows closed silently around her and took her in. When Kit had sobbed herself out, she lay for a long time, too exhausted to move or to think. Perhaps she slept a little, but presently she opened her eyes and became aware of the smell of the warm earth and the rough grass against her face. She rolled over and stretched, blinking up at the blue sky. The tips of the long grasses swished gently in the breeze. The hot sun pressed down on her so that her body felt light and empty. Slowly, the meadow began to fulfill its promise. All at once, with an instinctive quickening of her senses, Kit knew that she was not alone, that someone was very close. She started up. Only a few feet away, a woman was sitting watching her, a very old woman with short cropped white hair and faded, almost colorless eyes set deep in an incredibly wrinkled face. As Kit stared at her, she spoke in a rusty, murmuring voice.
He did well, child, to come to the meadow. There is always a cure here when the heart is troubled.
For a moment, Kit was too dumbfounded to move.
I know. Many's the time I've found it here myself. That is why I live here.
Kit stiffened with a cold prickle against his spine. Those thin, steep shoulders, that tattered gray shawl. This was the queer woman from Blackbird Pond, Hannah Tupper, the witch. The girl stared, horror-struck, at the odd-shaped scar on the woman's forehead. Was it the devil's mark?
Folks wonder why I want to live here so close to the swamp. But I think he knows why. I could see it in thy face a moment back. The meadow has spoken to thee, too, hasn't it?
The cold feeling began to pass away. In some unexplainable way, this strange little creature seemed to belong here, so much a part of this quiet, lonely place that her voice might have been the voice of the meadow itself. I didn't really intend to come here, Kit found herself explaining. I always meant to come back, but this morning I just seemed to get here by accident. Hannah Tupper shook her head, as though she knew better.
He must be hungry. Come, and I'll get thee a bite to eat.
I must go back. I must have been gone for hours. The woman peered up at her, her eyes almost lost in the folds of leathery wrinkles, had a humorous gleam. A toothless smile crinkled her cheeks.
He better not go back looking so. Whatever it is, we can stand up to it better with a bit of food inside. Come along. Here's no distance at all.
Kit wavered. She was suddenly ravenous, but more than that, she was curious. Whatever this queer little woman might be, she was certainly harmless and unexpectedly appealing.
Kit and Hannah Tupper became good friends. Now that was fortunate and unfortunate. It was fortunate because finally Kit had someone in whom she could confide, a good friend, an intelligent, wonderful woman. It was unfortunate because everyone considered Hannah Tupper a witch, and by association, Kit was going to be considered a witch also. I think you'll enjoy The Witch of Blackbird Pond by Elizabeth George Spear.